the most exemplary miserableness. He would weep copiously and frequently. She could always make him weep when she wanted to do so, by holding out hopes and then dashing them, if by no other expedient. Why did Mr. Britling never weep? She wept. Some base streak of competitiveness in Mr. Britling's nature made it seem impossible that he should relinquish the lady to Oliver. Besides, then, what would he do with his dull days, his afternoons, his need for a properly demonstrated affection? So Mr. Britling trod the path of his eighth digression, rather overworked in the matter of flowers and the selection of small jewelry, stalked by the invisible and indefatigable Oliver, haunted into an unwilling industry of attentions, attentions on the model of the professional lover of the French novels, by the memory and expectation of tearful scenes.
"Then you don't love me, and it's all spoiled. I've risked talk and my reputation. I was a fool ever to dream of making love beautifully."
Exactly like running your car into a soft, wet ditch, when you cannot get out and you cannot get on, and your work and your interests waiting and waiting for you. The car itself was an outcome of the affair. It was Mrs. Harrowdean's idea. She thought chiefly of pleasant expeditions to friendly inns in remote parts of the country, inns with a flavor of tacit complicity. But it fell in very pleasantly with Mr. Britling's private resentment at the extraordinary inconvenience of the railway communications between Matching Zizi and her station at Pyecrafts, which involved a journey to Liverpool Street and a long wait at a junction,